Away, boys, away. Away. Yeah, right on. Say fare thee well, young, pretty young girls. For we're brown for the Rio Grande. Welcome, adventurers. Welcome, deal seekers. Welcome, mystery, mysterious people. Welcome to the Gaming Galleon. I am Cap'n Rez, and let me tell you something. Life on a pirate ship, my friends. Life on a pirate ship is good. We're way down south from where the galleon sits 6 days, 7 days a week. Indianapolis. We're way down south in Pueblo City, Mexico. Why, you may ask? Well, we're here for Cinco De Mayo. As you can see, I brought some friends along. Donald and Pike have been tying one on. They've been treating us real nice here. We're going to be here for the next day or so. There's a parade tomorrow, Cinco de Mayo. Today's the 4th. We decided to get here a little early, obviously, to do the show for you guys. And, you know, so that we don't have to, you know, spend all that time traveling on the holiday. Who wants to do that, right? So there's a parade going on. Biz has been running around, putting decos up. He says he's got a pinata ready to go. I'm really excited about that. He says the end of the show, we'll have a pinata. We'll see if that happens. Who knows? We're going to be playing the perfect game to celebrate south of the border. Sega's Mexican masterpiece, Samba de Domingo, made by Sonic Team. This is a game I haven't, I never got to play. I wasn't really that excited about when it came out for the Sega Dreamcast, because frankly, there were quite a few great games to play on the Sega Dreamcast. Fighting games, action games, RPGs, and of course, shooters. So, a rhythm game like Samba de Domingo, which is about a Mexican monkey with a sombrero who uses maracas to beat out songs, was not high on my list. Also, the price tag for this game was through the roof. While most Dreamcast games, when they came out, especially when Dreamcast was on its way out, when it was discontinued, most Dreamcast games, even more sought-after games like Cannon Spike and Bengayo and Illbleed, those were all games that were coming in at $30. But Samba de Domingo was costing you somewhere around 70 or 80. Why? It's a rhythm game. Are you kidding me? Well, like many rhythm games, Samba de Domingo had a twist. Okay? Like many rhythm games, you had an instrument. And you didn't have a guitar. And you didn't have drums. You didn't even have a dance mat, which was really the peripheral of choice during that turn of the century era. No, no, my friends. In order to experience Samba de Domingo in its full capacity, you had to spend, in addition to the game, some extra money for a pair. And I'm not kidding around here. For a pair of maracas. Okay? I swear. Raz, you really spent $80 on maracas? No, I got lucky one day, and I happened to find these at a thrift store. They're actually pretty durable and pretty heavy. And the object of Samba de Domingo is you either have to shake high, shake medium, or shake low in conjunction with the prompts on the screen. Now, unfortunately, my maracas are incomplete. They have this little port that's certainly not designed for a Sega Dreamcast. So, unfortunately, these we're not going to be able to use these today. We're going to be using a regular controller that probably makes the game 10,000 times easier. But it'll probably be a little nicer here because you won't be hearing me do this in the background for 20 minutes. So, unfortunately, we're not going to be able to use this. Also, when I got these maracas, they came with this piece. Oops. Oh, my God. This is a little foot mat here. Take a look at that. Okay, so that's where we're supposed to stand. And if you take a look there, you see that Velcro there? That is where you're supposed to put this big gray sensor bar. And then you plug the maracas into the sensor bar. You plug the sensor bar into the Sega Dreamcast. And then you can experience Samba de Domingo in its full capacity. Some of you may be like, why did you even pick this game? There's no other Mexican games you could have played. Sure, there are. But I don't know. It's a celebration. It's Cinco de Mayo. And also, if you remember, Cinco de Mayo is about Mexican independence. So I thought, what better way to celebrate Mexican independence than to say, you know what, corporate America, screw you. I don't care if you're going to demonetize this video because I run a bunch of licensed music. We're doing it anyway. Now, I may never make a red cent on this video because I can't put a commercial on it. But I know you guys out there are going to be able to appreciate these songs in their entirety, day after day, week after week, year after year. And really, that's what independence is all about. One side note, while we are celebrating Mexico's independence here in Pueblo City, Mexico, let me show you where that is, by the way. It's interesting. This whole Cinco de Mayo thing is actually more of an American holiday than a Mexican holiday. Can you believe that? Believe it or not, Cinco de Mayo is celebrated more prevalently in America than south of the border. The biggest celebration of Cinco de Mayo in the world is in Los Angeles. And as for what Cinco de Mayo is actually all about, it's not about independence. That's not the day that Mexico declared their independence. That's sometime in September. What Cinco de Mayo is actually about is about a battle during the Mexican-French War. So, if I can get my pen, which I lost, of course. Here it is. Pueblo City, Mexico. Pueblo City, Mexico, which is where we are. It's right about here. Of course, this is my artist rendering. Got the U.S. here, South America, and here's Mexico. And that's Pueblo City. Now, Cinco de Mayo all happened when Napoleon showed up right around here and tried to get 6,000 troops onto Mexican plains. And his plan was to just start taking over and moving his way up all the way into America. Why? Well, this was 1862. And what was going on in America in 1862? The Civil War. So Napoleon's plan was to send some troops over there, because at the time, he had the mightiest army in the world, believe it or not. The French army was like head and shoulders above everyone else at this time. His plan was to go up here and help out the South. Why? Not because he wanted the South to win, but just because he wanted the Civil War to continue as long as possible so that the U.S. would just eat away at itself. Now, obviously, that didn't happen. Why? Well, these 6,000 troops weren't counting on the 2,000 troops in Puebla City. Take this, YouTube. Down. No way. Just why don't you just stay down? Seems like a lot of work just getting back up all the time. I'm actually, seems like the, oh, wow. Alright, the music's, dead. Just kind of, the margarita's kind of hitting me a little bit, hold on. Here we go, Macarena. Yeah, you guys still watching? Booty segment's next! Best part about this. Oh, I blew it already. Ugh. Oh my gosh. Oh, listen to this guitar. I got really bad score there. Game over. All right, we're coming back. Let me get my ukulele transition here. All right. We're back. So how about that music, huh? Think you want to rush out and get this? Hey, if you want to, it's on the Nintendo Wii. And it couldn't be cheaper. It's just a few bucks. I haven't played with that, but I assume you use the Wii? The Wiimotes? Obviously the maracas are cooler, but really, these days you're looking at probably around $100 to get a full set of this. Stupid rhythm game. And in my defense, I think there may be... I don't know. I guess I'm used to playing on my big TV where I can see the blue dots a lot better. But I'm much better at this at home than I have been on the ship. Maybe the water rocking the boat back and forth is throwing my rhythm off. Anyway, enough of the excuses. Let's get to the booty segment, which I'm quite excited about. It's very middling, because I remember at the time this was not that great of a lot. You may remember a while back, I basically took a lot from out from underneath a pawn dealer's nose. This guy had been hoarding games in the back room, and one of his colleagues got sick of it and basically sold all the good stuff to me while this hoarder was gone. Well, fast forward, a month later, and I go back to the store. The guy I pulled the rug out from under. He's not even talking to me now. And now he's so disgusted that he's put everything he ever had out on the floor. Now, the first time around, I picked the absolute cream of the crop, and there was a lot of it. There was some good stuff. This time around, I seem to remember picking up some decent stuff, and all of it was going to be for a buck. Okay? I have not looked in this bag since. I believe it was a buck. Maybe the receipt's in there, so we can double-check that. But, you know, it might have been $2 each. I sincerely doubt it, though. It's probably a buck each. Let's take a look at what's in there, because I don't really remember. I know there's PlayStation 2 stuff. Let's see.
All right, let's get started.
Oh, man. All right, so here we go, big bag. Okay? She double bagged it, so I can't even really see what's in there. God bless her. Here we go. By the way, the clerk who was helping me out with this, she said, good for you. Good for you taking that stuff. That guy's got a bad attitude. I'm like, yeah, well, bad attitude or not, if the stuff's there for sale, it's there for sale. Can't be mad at me for it. All right, let's take a look here. Got some PlayStation 1 games. It's pretty cool. Out of the box, we have Putter Golf, which doesn't look like much, but it's got Age Tech down there. Age Tech was known for releasing a number of budget titles in Japan, and a number of them making it out here. And the funny thing about them is, while they had a budget price tag, some of them were extremely innovative. Some of them were the kind of things you didn't see anywhere in the library. Anywhere else in the PlayStation library, two games that come to mind are Top Shop and the excellent, excellent Battle Hunter. There was even like a good fighting game that was very... This company made like the most boring names. Here we have Putter Golf. They made games like... I'm not kidding. The entitled games called Racing, Snowboarding, Boxing. Kickboxing. Now, they had the most generic names and casings, but the games within were normally something pretty special. So I would not be surprised if this game, which apparently is about miniature golf, I would not be surprised if this is actually pretty darn good. So there. I can't say that for sure, but I'm just going by the brand. All right. Another PlayStation 1 game here. We have Armor Marines. Project Swarm. I believe this might have been on the N64 as well. And apparently this is in a Crash Bandicoot case. So it's just a disc and it looks pretty horrible. I don't know if it's going to work or not. We'll see. Sled Storm, which I believe we have, looks good. Snowboarding game? Insane Snowmobile. Snowmobile racing. Okay. Yeah. Oh, alright. This is pretty nice. Hydro Thunder for the PS1. Very good game on pretty much every system it was on. Probably the best would be the Dreamcast.
very attractive looking disc for a PS1. Very colorful. It's pretty cool. Looks like it's going to play just fine. So that's nice. Okay. So I believe this is the only PS3 game that was out there, and it was on the floor, of all things. You know, you're used to seeing things like, you know, Guitar Hero, Van Halen, and, you know, whatever, Madden 2010 or something. Among all those boring titles, we found a game that I'm not even sure I can pronounce. Atelier Roranon? The Alchemist of Arlen. And I believe this is the first in the series, but it's basically, it's very, very JRPG. You're playing this cute little sweetheart in a dress who happens to be an alchemist. You know. I believe there's a few of these. It probably paid $5 on this since it's a PS3 game, but any JRPG for the PS3... I'm usually gonna pick up. I don't know what we did on this. Is there a receipt? I don't think there's a receipt. You're gonna have to take my word for it. If I don't have a receipt here, I'm gonna go high on all this stuff, okay? So that means the PlayStation 1 games, I'm sure, were $1. The PS3 games, normally most guys are charging around $2.50 these days, but I'm gonna go high because I don't have a receipt. I'm not gonna lie to you guys, I'm not gonna embellish. I would rather come away making it seem like it's not that great of a deal rather than make it an awesome deal and not be sure that I'm telling you the truth. So truthfully, there's no way they would have sold it, or I wouldn't have bought it for any less than $5. Okay, so we'll say the $5 on the PS3 game. And then everything here, these look like they're all PS2 games. The highest they would have gone on them are $2. And since I have no proof that I paid less than that, we're going to have to just assume I did $2 on these, okay? Let's see what we got. I have no idea what's in here. $2 we had Soul Calibur 3. Never played Soul Calibur 3. Pretty much just played Soul Calibur 1 for Dreamcast. I hear this one had a pretty interesting... Yeah, create your own character for an all-new real-time strategy adventure. Employ strategy and classic combat to ensure your team's victory. So that seems like an interesting side game. I don't really know how good it is. Sounds kind of cool. Original PlayStation. I wouldn't have paid any more than $1 on this. And this game's so common, I feel like they must have given me less than $1, but we'll say $1. Namco Museum Volume 3. Got Ms. Pac-Man, Dig Dug, Galaxian, Pole Position 2. Tower Jiraga's in this? Huh. And then Fozom. I'm not familiar with that. That must be a shooter. It's kind of cool. Alright. Driver Parallel Lines, huh? This is, memory serves, this is one of the, this is actually kind of hard to find. It's pretty cool. It's complete. Driver was an excellent game on the PS1. And this one doesn't look half bad. I wonder where it takes place. Hollywood, no, it doesn't say. Didn't say where it takes place. Now I want to know. Let's look at the instructions here. Shouldn't take too long, should it? Of course it should. Yeah, it's... I don't know. Sorry. Forget it. We'll pass. Who knows? I'll look it up later. Alright. Jack and Daxter. I believe at the time I was buying this, a friend of mine was just wanting a PS2. I found a PS2 for him, and I think I was just picking these up for cheap. They must have been $1, man, because I don't know why I'd do $2 on Jack and Daxter. But this is cool. It comes with the pretty interesting-looking manual there. Jack, my boy, I hope this comes in handy on your quest. Good luck, your uncle. That's pretty cool. Is this a big map? Oh, this is. This isn't just a... This isn't an instruction manual at all. It's a map. Wow. Classy. Pretty cool poster there. Half poster, and then this really neat map. Oh, I like that a lot. Pretty cool. Not bad. I don't think I've ever seen that before. Huh. Very neat. It looks like it's got all the moves in there. I wonder if this is... Yeah, it looks like this doubles as the instruction manual. That's neat. A for presentation, Naughty Dog. Let's put that away later. Alright. Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater. Never played this one. I think I had like one session with it, and I was just kind of done. I played the first and the second one. Loved the first one. Second one was a little weird. Sea Monsters, a prehistoric adventure. I know we don't have this. Experience the adventures of the giant screen film. Okay. Not very descriptive, is it?
Alright, fair enough.
Bikini Bottom. This is a really good platformer. Again, this would have made somebody's day who was just getting a PS2. And this one's still relatively... Well, it's probably not worth anything these days. Maybe the GameCube one. I don't know about this one. Sly Cooper. I mean, this is kind of like all the basics really are in here. Sly Cooper. Very nice copy. Thievius Raccoonus. You even got the Thievius Raccoonus in there. Great art on these PS2 platformer mascot games. For the manual, at least. Very creative. Project Eden. I just think this is one we didn't have. So I grabbed it for the hold. Not sure what to make of it. Looks like it's 1-4 player co-op, though. From the creators of Tomb Raider 1 and 2. No manual. Okay. This is a game we're gonna do one day. This is such a great game. This is a game you're not gonna believe it. I actually ordered this. I went out of my way to order this game. I believe I was playing Star Wars Battlefront 2. Star Wars Battlefront. Maybe it was. No, it wasn't even. It was like. It was late. It was like PS3 era. And I meet some guy, I think playing Uncharted 2. And for whatever reason, we get on the subject of favorite games, and he says, Backyard Wrestling, don't try this at home. And I ended up picking it up for the original Xbox, and it was all we ever talked about, was this game. I played it all the way through. Loved it. I've had it for the original Xbox for years, and I finally here, we find it for the PlayStation 2. Backyard Wrestling... Don't try this at home. Why is this a great game? Have you ever wanted to beat a guy up in, you know, a backyard or like a shop class or something? This game is hilarious. It's way over the top. There's just like weapons everywhere. The insane clown posse is in this. What a hilarious game. And I believe this is the sequel. I believe there were two of these. So... Jackass meets the squared circle in America's backyard, says official PlayStation Magazine. Great game. What a riot. I haven't played in years. I would love to play it again. Soul Calibur 3 again, apparently. This is the Black Label version. Oh, okay. Well, the cool thing about this is this one, in addition to the game, had a little demo disc. that it released with. So that's cool. Additional content to fool around with there. All right, Final Fantasy 12. Very easy to find, but again, I knew I had a friend who was gonna have a PS2, so I grabbed these for him. I may still give him these. It's been a while. Twisted Metal Black. Wow, cool. Twisted Metal Black. You see this all the time, but what you don't see is this little label down here, which I believe we may have talked about before. It says bonus disc includes Twisted Metal Online. So it's got two discs in here. And I believe one is just the vanilla Twisted Metal Black. And the second one is the exact same game. It just gives you the ability to play the game online. Yeah, here. Includes bonus disc, Twisted Metal Online, the same exact game, but now you can raise heck online. What better way to hook up with friends? Huh. It's weird. Why would they give you both discs? Seems like a waste of resources. I don't know. PlayStation 2 video game. All right, Way of the Samurai. This is the first game I bought for the PlayStation 2. I still have my original copy. It's kind of an open-world feudal Japan game. You spend 3 days in this village, and it's kind of like a BioWare game, where your decisions and conversations play into what happens next. Oh wow, Buffy the Vampire Chaos Bleeds. 4-player fighting game, Buffy. Very good buy for $1 or even $2. Oh, this is for the Xbox. Okay. That's pretty cool. Tony Hawk Project 8. Now I know I bought these for $1 each. There's no way I would have paid $2 on this. Absolutely not. I don't even want to look at the back. I'm that uninterested. Final Fantasy X2, plenty of copies of this floating around. Again, pretty much getting that for the friend. Almost done here. Mortal Kombat Deadly Alliance. Strange that this is not that easy to find. Deception, Armageddon, Shaolin Monks, you'll see those all day. Something about Deadly Alliance, the first game where they moved into the 3D realm. Well, where they really got the 3D realm right, I should say. There's less of these out there. I just don't see them, and I'm not sure that we had it. So I think I grabbed it just because I don't think we had a copy. It doesn't hold a candle to any of the other games, but I grabbed it anyway. For $1, we had Harry Potter, Goblet of Fire. Best thing about this game is it's 3-player. I wonder who I'd play. Maybe Ron. I don't know. And then finally, copy of The Chronicles of Narnia, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe for the GameCube. Complete. So I don't know, you be the judge. I'm going to count them up as a buck, because after looking at some of these, there's no way I would have paid $2. And Tony Hawk. I left stuff behind. And Tony Hawk would have been one of them. So let's take a look. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. $13, $14, $15, $16, $17, $18, $19, $20. The PS1 games. There were four of them, so we'll say $20 a buck each on those, $24. And then I'm going to go high. I bet this was like $2-3, but I'll go high because I don't know for sure. This JRPG for the PS3, $5. So $24, plus five, $29. $29 on that. I'm not sure we can really get any cheddar back on that, to be honest. PS2 games, they gotta be something special these days to be able to turn around. And like I said, I'd already pulled all the special stuff out that first time around, but I decided to pick up a lot of stuff for a friend. All those Jack and Daxters, you know, all that's Final Fantasy 12. That's all stuff we had. Basically, I grabbed it for my buddy. You know, whatever. Spend a dollar here or there for your friends. You know, it'll come back to you eventually. Anyway, that's it. Let's get back to Samba de Mingo. We got some time here for another game or two. A few more songs. Where's my kabong? And on a side note, we've got Donald over here in his poncho and sombrero. My favorite Disney movie ever is called The Three Caballeros, and it's about Donald, his birthday, and he gets a package from Mexico. And as he begins to open it, each package turns into an adventure in different parts of Mexico. It's not around very often. I think you can get it on DVD, but you know, this is not one you're going to find very often. My mother's always like, oh, that's your favorite Disney movie? You always have to be so obscure about everything. But there it is. Great songs. And if you're ever down in Disney World or Epcot Center in the Mexico area, there's actually a Three Caballero ride. So, anyway, just a side note, if you're wondering why Donald was here, he's mine. I couldn't come down to Pueblo City without him. So there you go. All right, let's get back to somebody, Domingo. For the Sega Dreamcast. Oh, man, it's active. Wish I was living in that world. All right, I'm going to kick it this time. I'm going to get really serious. I'm going to shut up and really score high here this time. Because I know I can do it. All right. To avoid hitting maracas. That's if you're doing two-player. That's if you decided to spend $160 on this game. So you and your friend could play. Did I say that already? Cup of life, baby! Do you really want it? Oh, just shy of an A. Dang it. All right, let's go one more, and then we'll come back because I hear we have a pinata ready to go. Gonna do one more song here. Take on Me. Definitely. It's a Take on Me. Look at a mango. Boom. I got a C. Look, it got me. C's got me through college. Come on. All right, that's it. We're done. We're done with Samba de Domingo. Even though I could play forever. Samba de Domingo! How does that happen? How can you not want to play with that kind of reception? All right, gang. Hippazine. So Zingo, 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 Zingo. All right, how are we doing on time here? All right, good. So without further ado, I think we have our pinata. And from what I understand, the letter's going to be inside it. So let's see if we can get it. All right, so bring it down.
Here's the bat.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Biz. I appreciate you getting this for me.
Yeah, no problem.
All right. Get ready, everybody. Can you reach it?
Yeah.
There we go.
All right, yeah, you bring it down.
Yeah, I'm ready. Bring it down.
Yeah.
Bring it down. What are you doing? What's on the shot?
Getting her on shot. Okay. All right, ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. That's it? That's the pinata?
You got your bat, right?
You gave me a bat for this?
Yeah, you got a bat.
Yeah, count of three. One. That's fine. Count of three. One, two. All right, great. I did it. That's it. I'm done. All right, great. Thanks for the pinata. Look, we only have so much money on this show, okay? All right, let's get to the mailbag. Let's see if anybody's got any. Bats and electronic components, not good. Best time ever. All right, thanks, guys. Do I have my hat? There we go. Right, anything else here? Holy crap, that guy is tall. He's not tall. I'm short. Believe it or not. That's usually how it works out. All right, let's Let's check out the mailbag, shall we? Thank you, Biz. Let's give him a hand. Let's give him a hand. Thank you for the pinata. All right. You want to stay on for this?
Sure.
All right, come on in. Where'd my drink go?
Oh, I'm like 6 foot.
Sure. Pike's taller. Captain Pike back here. Donald's shorter than all of us. All right. What do we got? Oh, how about that? This letter comes from a longtime fan. One of the sweetest crewmen to be sauntering around the boat during our adventures. This is from Dark Haired Beauty.
Hmm.
All right. She has to say, have you always been infatuated with pirates and the sea? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I think that my real infatuation comes from travel. The ability to be on some sort of vessel with, you know, a group of people, and you're all experiencing this migration together, and everybody's got a job, everybody's got a position, and you all work together to make it happen. I think that's where it really came from, the pirate thing. Just, you know, I happened to win a pirate ship, so that's where that came from. Not to say I didn't love pirates before, but do I love pirates more than the sea? No, I think I love the sea more. I think I would love to be able to experience that freedom of getting on a boat and just going. Those are always my favorite movies, are the ones that end where they're in a boat, or they somehow get away with some sort of caper, and they're like, there's the sunset, let's go. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, I think I've always been kind of infatuated with travel and the sea, and the life of a pirate is a good one, I'd say. Agree?
I would agree.
All right. You got anything else? I love the sea. I love Pueblo City, Mexico. We're going to have a good time tomorrow. We're going to go down and see the parade. I don't think it's going to be anything too crazy. Like I said, apparently this is not nearly as big of a deal in Mexico as in Los Angeles. But I think we're going to have a good time. It should be an interesting, wholesome little adventure. We'll have some drinks, have some good times, and then we'll head back to Indianapolis. But we had to part ways with you now. The hour is up. So let me don my mug here. You want to do the uke?
Sure.
All right. Where's my mug? Here it is. Oh, man. Farewell and adieu mug. All right. Thanks again for joining us. We had a great time here in Pueblo City, Mexico. Who knows where we're going to head to next on the Gaming Galleon. But we know one thing's for sure, it's just not going to be the same unless you're there on deck with us. So make sure you can make it next time. Until then, well, an adieu to ye Spanish maidens. Well, an adieu, ye ladies of Spain. For we received orders for to head down to Mexico. And we may never see ye fair ladies all gone. Keep your powder dry, mateys.
Go, go, go! Ole, ole, ole!
I should leave.
Well, you've been doing this for 70 shows. All right.